It should do it. Computer is thinking. All right. It should do it.
All righty.
Computer is thinking.
Okay, I see the link.
All right.
I'm clicking the link.
All right. Okay, it says now playing. Hopefully this is going live. It's our first time doing this. So, I should click out of that myself.
All righty.
So we don't get an echo.
Is it okay that I have it up on my computer?
I think so, because okay. You'll mute yourself after you talk and
okay. That
won't be an issue. All right, so I think we're live, and if not, we'll post this recording later so that everyone can see it. And I'll hand it over to you.
Okay. Well, hi, everyone. Good morning, and welcome to the 2021 Virtual Bug Bowl. We're kicking things off this week talking about the periodical cicadas, which will be emerging here in Indiana, well, and across many states, actually, 15 states, I think. But I'm here with Dr. Elizabeth Barnes, an exotic forest pest educator in the Department of Entomology. I am Dr. Elizabeth Long. So the Elizabeths are here to talk with you about cicadas. I'm an assistant professor of horticultural entomology here in the Department of Entomology at Purdue. So today we're gonna talk with you or share a little bit about periodical cicadas, answer any questions you might have, and hopefully get Bug Bowl kicked off in an exciting way for everyone. So I'm gonna turn it over to Elizabeth, and we'll open it up for Q&A after.
Great, thank you so much, Dr. Long. I am going to, I'm gonna share my screen. I start out with a quick little PowerPoint. I'm gonna tell you today about the emergence of the 17-year or periodical cicadas. And these cicadas have a long life cycle that they spend most of underground. They feed on tree roots there, so they're not actually chewing up the roots. They are just drinking the liquid out of those tree roots. Then they emerge after 17 years when the ground temperature is about 64 degrees Fahrenheit. Usually this is in May and they're out through June, but if the weather's really warm, you might get them a little bit earlier, so early into say mid-April at the very earliest. There will be a lot of these insects coming up. There can be up to 1.5 million cicadas per acre in some of the areas with the biggest emergences. So it'll be hard to miss. Once the cicadas emerge, they crawl up out of the ground. Once their bodies have hardened, the males will start to sing, and it is loud. The females will respond by clicking their wings, and then after they've mated, the females will lay their eggs into twigs on branches, and the eggs then hatch in those branches, drop to the ground, and the whole cycle repeats again. They can be found throughout Indiana and in other parts of the Midwest and even over into the East Coast. They will be mostly in Southern Indiana. We are at Purdue, if anyone's joining us from outside of Indiana, that's why we're so Indiana focused. But they should be mostly in Southern Indiana, although as you can see from this map, there are other areas throughout the state where we get cicada emergences as well. The only places you can have cicadas though are areas where there have been trees for at least 17 years. Cicadas really need to be feeding on trees for almost their entire life. So for example, if you had a forested area with a cicada emergence 17 years ago, and then there were trees that were cut down, all the trees in the area were cut down, say 15 years ago, and then there was a few year gap and then more trees were planted 10 years ago, you're still not gonna get cicadas even though there are trees there now, because there was that gap where the cicadas had nothing to eat. The nymphs really need those trees to feed on. What can you actually expect? Well, it is going to be loud. They sing during the day, and luckily they stop at night. If you hear noises at night, you think are cicadas. It's one of two things happening. Either one, these cicadas were startled, and sometimes they'll make a noise when they're startled, or two, it's actually some other insect that sings at night. For example, crickets will sing at night. They also will be probably some flagging on trees. So this is when you see the ends of branches sort of dying off. And it can look really scary if you don't. So it can look really scary if you don't know what it is. It almost looks like your tree is dying. But really what's happening is that the cicadas have laid their eggs into those small branches. Their ovipositors are like little swords. So they cut into the bark of the tree, and then the tree can't get nutrients to those branch tips, and then those die off. So really it's just the very end of the tree. None of the rest of the tree is damaged. And it's almost like the cicadas are giving the tree a little bit of a prune. Now, this is not an issue on larger trees, but smaller trees can have a problem. And we'd be happy to talk later about some ways you can protect smaller trees from this cicada damage. It's actually, it's pretty straightforward. It's pretty easy. It's not too expensive for most people either. So it's definitely something most people should be able to manage. The final thing is there's going to be an absolute feeding frenzy. Anything that can eat cicadas will eat cicadas. That's birds, fish, raccoons, foxes, turkeys, also, which are birds, I suppose. All sorts of animals will be gobbling up these cicadas and eating their fill. And this leads to some pretty interesting population changes. On the downside, we usually expect to see an uptick in the number of mice and rats following a cicada emergence because they've got such a good supply of food. But on the upside, we also tend to see turkeys in the falls after a cicada emergence are fatter. So that's something to look forward to. I wanted to highlight a few resources that we've got for you. Our Cicada website just went live, and I will be sharing links to that on the Purdue Entomology page later today, so stay tuned. You can find this beautiful cicada and their lookalikes poster on there. You can download it and then have it ready for when the cicadas emerge, excuse me, so that you can look at it and see, am I seeing a cicada? Am I seeing a different insect? It's just a nice little handy guide. Going to take a quick sip of water, sorry. Okay, hopefully that'll work. Next, we also have a program where we're doing a bio blitz later in the summer to sort of celebrate the emergence of these cicadas. We're calling it Indiana Cicada Fest. And again, I'll put a link to that on Facebook later today. It will be from May 1st to 9th. And all you need to do is go on to iNaturalist, join our iNaturalist project, Indiana Cicada Fest, pick your favorite spot to go outdoors where you think there'll be some cicadas emerging. And then during that week of May 1st through 9th, go outside and take pictures of any sort of interesting living creatures that you see. That can be plants, animals, fungi, and hopefully some cicadas too. Take those pictures, upload your observation, and they'll be automatically added to our iNaturalist project. And when all of that is done, we'll be sharing some of our favorite observations on our Purdue Entomology social media, as well as sharing some statistics with you. So please do join us for that. We're really excited about it. All right, so finally, just some key points about cicadas before we move on. First off, a lot of people are really worried about whether or not the cicadas are going to hurt them. Cicadas don't bite, they don't sting, they're not poisonous, they're not going to hurt you, they're not going to hurt your pets. Now, a couple quick caveats with that. As with anything, if you have an interaction with a cicada or your pet eats a bunch of cicadas and then start acting weird or you feel weird or something like that, always see a doctor if you're worried. Always take your animals to the vet if you're worried. One thing with animals eating cicadas is the cicadas are pretty big and it's possible that your pet can choke on them. So, you know, be wary of that as with any insect outdoors. And also if the cicadas have been treated with a pesticide and your pet eats them, that can also cause a problem. So there's nothing inherently dangerous about cicadas themselves. They have the same issues as any sort of insect outdoors would. So you don't need to worry. There's no special problem with the cicada emergence. The next point is a lot of people, particularly in the Midwest, use cicada and locust interchangeably. So when you hear 1.5 million cicadas per acre, you might start to worry because you think cicadas, locusts, plague of locusts, oh no. Well, cicadas and locusts are actually very different. Cicadas have piercing sucking mouth parts, which means basically their mouths are a little straw. They stick it into the tree, they drink the liquid out of the tree, and they might cause a little bit of growth reduction, but they don't have a huge impact on the trees. Whereas locusts have chewing mouth parts. So they actually can chew up the tissue on crops and eat the crops. And that's why you see the real devastation with locusts. So cicadas can't cause the same sort of damage as locusts do, even if they wanted to. They are different things. You don't need to worry about them in that way. Next, most trees will be fine. As I've mentioned before, if you're concerned about a smaller or a younger tree, or if you have any questions about fruit trees, we are happy to answer those. But most trees, it's not going to be an issue. What I'm showing over here is a tree that's been bagged to protect it from cicadas. What that does is it physically stops the female cicadas from getting on those branches and laying the eggs. And that's, you know, that for most people, that's all you need to do to protect your tree. So again, we can answer more questions. You can find more details on the Purdue Entomology webpage, but most trees are going to be okay. And lastly, if you don't like bugs and you're really not looking forward to this, don't worry, it'll be over in about a month and a half. And with that said, on the flip side, if you do like bugs, get out there and enjoy it. Make sure that you get to see this amazing event because again, they're gonna be gone in about a month and a half and they won't be back for another 17 years. And with that, I'm gonna stop sharing my screen and take any questions you guys might have.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Barnes. And I'm looking for questions on the live stream. I'm not sure where they're going to appear.
Oh, so if you click on the place with comments, they should appear that way. And it looks like the only two comments right now are my dad, who's telling us that he can hear us and we are live.
Awesome.
All right. And I see one now that says, do you know when they will emerge? So we are expecting them to emerge at the beginning of May. We are not 100% positive because like I said, if it gets really warm, they might emerge a little earlier. If we get a sudden cold snap, they might emerge a little later. What they're really waiting for is for the temperature to be that 64 degrees. Then they'll crawl up close to the surface of the ground and they'll wait for a warm rain. And then once that rain has stopped, they'll come up out of the ground. So they don't actually emerge while it's raining. They wait for the rain to stop. And I would guess, I don't know for sure, but I would guess that's because if they come up while it's raining, they might get knocked off of the branches once they've shed their shell. And they're pretty fragile at that stage. So if they get damaged or their wings get crumpled up at that stage, that's it for the cicada. So that would be my guess.
I think in our area in Indiana, we're typically in the past has maybe been around May, late May through June or so.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's also going to be different depending on the area in Indiana that you were in, I should say. Thank you for reminding me. So I was talking more about the very bottom southern Indiana, and then it's going to slowly continue all throughout the state. And if you're in a different state, it's going to be different for you as well. I think it's Cicada Mania actually has a really cool link where you can enter like the average temperature in the area that you're in and it'll give you an expected cicada emergence date. So if you want to be really precise, you can look there. All right, let's see. So I see another question is, do they emit secretions that are damaging? Not that I know of. They're honestly, they're just kind of big loud bugs that sort of bumble about. As far as I know, they don't have any kind of like damaging secretions. They're not toxic. They don't sequester any sort of toxins in their body like you would see in something like a monarch. So they're not dangerous in that way. And okay. Do you know what trees will be attacked? So they will feed on most deciduous trees, so trees that lose their leaves in the fall. They'll leave coniferous trees alone. As far as I know, they don't have any particular preferences. I don't know, Dr. Long, if you've encountered anything in your research where they go after particular trees, but as far as I've seen, they're pretty big generalists.
I would agree. I think that's right. I think in the literature, they attack more than 200 species of trees, deciduous trees, and those could be fruit trees, ornamental trees in your yard. So really any tree that has branches in that size category that are vulnerable, I'm trying to think, it's anywhere from, let's say, 0.2 to a quarter to a half an inch in diameter, are the size twigs, branches that these females are going to be looking to lay their eggs in. So any tree that has that size category is fair game.
Yes. Yeah. They're hungry and they'll just go after, you know, closest tree they can get to that fits those criteria. And I see someone else asked, how long do they live after emerging? Again, this can be variable, but my understanding is it's about a month that most of them live, maybe a little shorter, maybe a little longer, but most of them are out for about a month. So yeah, it's 17 years underground as these nymphs feeding on tree roots. And then they've got this short little period where they're above ground as the adult cicadas, and then they die.
So it looks like there's a question here in the Zoom chat. Is it true that the 13-year brood is also emerging?
I haven't heard anything about a 13-year brood emerging as well. I believe it's just the 17-year cicadas that are coming out right now. I don't think they overlap really anywhere that I know of. But you know, if somebody knows different, please feel free to throw that information in the chat. That would be news to me, and that would be kind of cool too to hear.
Okay, and let's see. So there's a question here. I was surprised that Tippecanoe County isn't listed as a site from the last emergence. That seems weird. Are there not many in Tippecanoe?
Yeah, so I wasn't in Tippecanoe County the last time there was a big emergence, but I've talked to lots of people who were, and they've said that there are some 17-year cicadas that do come out here, but it's not really that many. So it's not really noticeable unless you're an entomologist and you're going out and you're actually looking for them.
Yeah, and maybe that also has to do with the fact that we're not as heavily wooded in this area. So like down in the southern part of the state, there's just way more trees. Up here, we're kind of more corn and soybean.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. And I haven't done this formally in any way, so, you know, take it with a grain of salt. But if you look at the kind of the maps of cicada emergences over time, you can sort of see where land use was changing over time. So as I said earlier, if you get rid of trees, then the cicadas don't have anything to feed on. So you lose the 17-year cicada emergence.
Okay, some other couple of good questions here. do you have a favorite recipe for eating the cicadas?
So this is something that's kind of cool. There's a long history of people eating cicadas. Sorry, tickle at my nose. I have never tried them myself. I've never cooked them myself. I've heard some people will fry them up and that's really good. I heard of one place that put them in ice cream and it was apparently tasty. Couple things I do want to warn people about. I mean, A, I think it's kind of a fun way to engage with the emergence is actually eating these insects because there's so many of them. But so any sort of insect, if you have a shellfish allergy, you might want to avoid insects because a lot of people with shellfish allergies are actually allergic to insects as well. So just, you know, be careful there. And then the other thing is, as with anything that you're gathering in the wild, just, you know, be careful about which ones you're choosing to eat. So you really want to know, like, for example, we don't want anyone accidentally eating cicadas off of an area where somebody has treated the cicadas with pesticides or something like that. So be careful, but also it's a great long tradition of eating cicadas. I want to say it's Michigan State has a recipe book that you can find if you search online. There are some great recipe books out there. So that's what I'll say about that.
Awesome. Okay, another question I see here. Will there be more cicada killers due to brood X?
So this is a really interesting question, and I need to check in with our bee and wasp expert on this, because my suspicion is that the life cycle of the cicada killers is more lined up with our annual cicadas, which come out in August. So I think that the cicada killers are probably going to be out and laying their eggs after most of the 17-year cicadas have already died. But I don't know. It's possible they might overlap a little and we might see an uptick in cicada killers. But that's a really interesting question. And let me see. So somebody asks, how far do they travel from their point of emergence? And let's see. So I don't know for sure. I don't know if anybody's actually studied this, but they're pretty poor flyers. So they have those big wings and they look like they would be really good at traveling long distances, but they're also very, very heavy. So most cicadas aren't going to fly terribly far from where they first emerge. So they're not gonna move around a lot, really. So I know somebody else in another cicada event was wondering if they'd like move into neighborhoods from the forest. So like with something like that, my guess would be is if there's a forest right next to a neighborhood and it like they're right next to each other, like the cicadas might move that distance. But if it's a question of like there's a forest and then there's a mile gap and then there's a neighborhood and you're wondering if they'll travel from one place to another, I would be very surprised if they would move that distance. They're pretty lazy and they're just not really capable of flying too far.
Yeah, I think this question came up earlier this week on an email that both Elizabeth and I were on, and I looked into the literature. Granted, it was a little dated, but they estimated no more than 50 meters. Mm-hmm. And yeah, just because they are clumsy, bumbly, heavy flying tanks.
Oh.
Okay, let's see. Another question. Did Purdue count locally last time?
I don't. Dr. Long, I mean, have you encountered any records of that? I haven't seen any records.
Unfortunately, neither of us was here to experience the last glorious emergence. Yeah, that would be a good question for maybe the educators or locally or even master gardeners, but I don't know off the top of my head.
Yeah, it's cicadas, the 17-year cicadas are one of those things where it's such a big event and people have all these really interesting questions about them. And unfortunately, because it's such a long gap in between when they emerge, it's really hard to study them. So a lot of these questions, it's not that you know, researchers aren't curious about them. It's just that you have to like cram as much research as you possibly can into this 1 month period every 17 years, unless you study the nymphs underground, then you've got a little more wiggle room.
Okay, let's see the next question. How long till eggs hatch in limbs?
I believe it's a week or two, I think. Let me double check that. And I will answer that later, unless you know off the top of your head.
I think I am just taking a look here.
Perfect.
So it's kind of slow, surprisingly slow.
Is it? So it's within the same summer period. So they're not going to like wait a year in the branches. It's within the summer. They lay their eggs, they hatch, they drop to the ground, they burrow underground as fast as they possibly can.
Mm-hmm. Looks like 4 to 6 weeks. Some places will say up to 7 weeks before they hatch, but that's all temperature dependent. So could probably guess the warmer it is, the little bit quicker, but seems about a month.
Yeah, I was underestimating. Thank you for looking that up.
No problem.
Okay, let's see. We have a question here that says, does anything eat the shells? I don't think so. The shells, at least with other insects that shed their shells, the shells can actually hang around for a really long time if they're in a sheltered area. It's made up of a substance that not a lot of things really eat. I don't think anything would eat the shells themselves. But when they fall apart, they'll get into the soil and they'll be slowly broken down by fungi and bacteria and things like that. But I've never read of anything eating the shells themselves. And because the same is true for like dragonflies have a similar life cycle where they crawl up and then cling onto something, molt, and then you can find the exuvia hanging onto things. So that's the shells hanging onto things. And you have this like perfect little mold of a dragonfly nymph that you can pull off and identify and figure out what kind of dragonflies were in a pond. But I've never read of anything. I've spent more time reading about dragonflies and I've never come across anything that eats those shells. And I would guess the same is true of cicadas. All right. And we have someone here who was an educator and was in the area last time. And they've said that they don't recall anyone counting then. But if anyone out there wants to do like a survey and, you know, survey the cicadas in the area and make an attempt to count them, that would be a cool project. And I don't see any more questions on here right now. Give it a second.
I guess I'll ask one just for listeners who may think of this later. What about other crops like non-trees or vegetable crops? Should people be worried about cicadas damaging those?
No. So cicadas, they really only are going to go after the trees. The deciduous trees are the only thing they're feeding on. You don't have to worry about your plants. They're not going to go after any, corn is the big concern here, of course, as well as soybeans. And there are other big crops here. And they're not going to go after any of those. They're not going to go after your flowers. It's really only those deciduous trees that they feed on. They're not picky about which species of deciduous trees, but they are picky in terms of only feeding on deciduous trees. All right. And someone on here said they downloaded the Cicada Safari app to count. Excellent. Yeah, that's a very cool program where they're trying to collect data on cicadas in as many places as possible. And they're asking people to download this app and take pictures of the cicadas and submit them there. And there's actually a live map that you can look at where it's going to pop up and have all the areas as the cicadas emerge. So that's also a really good place to keep track of when the cicadas are starting to pop up. Okay. Do other insects feed on them underground? These are so many good questions. So there are other things that eat them underground. I don't remember the specifics off the top of my head. I was reading about this a while ago, so I don't remember it off the top of my head, but there are things that as they come across them underground, they will eat them. But there's, as far as I know, there's nothing that specifically targets cicadas. Okay. And I think that brings us to the end of our time. If anyone else has any few last questions, we'd be happy to stay on for a couple minutes, but otherwise I think we will wrap this up. Just clicking back and forth. Nope, I don't see any more questions. So thank you all for coming today. We really appreciate it. Again, keep your eyes peeled. We're going to be posting all sorts of other cicada information throughout the day. We've also got some videos up, one about zombie cicadas, if that's something that interests you, one about how to bake cookies using cricket flour and then decorate them like cicadas and their lookalikes. And then finally, if you want to make your very own origami cicadas, we have some instructions on how to do that as well. So thank you for coming.
Thanks, everyone.